want to call it that, gave my life to Messiah on October the 8th, 1978. And I felt the presence of Yeshua come into my heart. And if you do your math, that's been a while. And sometimes you believers are zealous. I was listening to a preacher on the radio as I was traveling. I do a lot of back and forth taking people here and there, mainly my kids. And one of the preachers was saying that the statistics are phenomenal, that most people that are witnessing about the gospel are young converts. And they were in one particular place, and there was a lot of young people there witnessing about Messiah and the gospel. And he came to find out that almost every one of them had only known the Lord probably a year or less. I mean, very young in the faith. And he said, that's typical. A lot of times after people have been in the faith for a while, different things happen to them, and they don't seem to have that excitement. They don't seem to have that edge, that zeal, that love, that first love, and things happen to them. And so, I don't know, I was just a young boy when that happened to me years later in the summer of 1983. I was baptized or immersed with the Ruach HaKodesh. I was baptized with the Holy Spirit, and I can remember the fire of God coming into my life, and I can really feel the presence of God. And so then I got on fire again for a while. And so I've seen people at different times and in different reasons, just really things happen to them. And then I see different things happen to people where things aren't happening. And not that we're trying to judge, we're not here to judge each other, but sometimes you just can kind of see the fruit. You know, we have fruit on a little basket on the island in my kitchen, and when the fruit starts to look a certain way, I threw it out. I guess it was this week I threw away a whole bunch of apples, because I was going to eat an apple. I cut it open, and it didn't look good. And so I started looking at several of them, and I just threw them all away, because they didn't look good to eat. And so sometimes you have to make the judgment call, and preferably with yourself. You know, where am I at? What's going on here? What do I need to do? Physically speaking, we're all humans. We're all very different, and there's nothing wrong with that. I believe God created creation. When I go to the zoo, I like to see variation. I wouldn't like to see every animal look just the same, sound just the same. That'd be very boring. I like to see the colors and the sounds and the smells. And so even with us as humans, you know, don't think that you have to look a certain way. Oh, I've got to look this way in order to be holy. I've got to dress this way. I've got to have this look. You know, be careful of that. Oh, I've got to sound like this. I've got to make my prayer sound more Hebraic. I've got to make my worship sound more Jewish. You know, if you want to, that's fine, but it's not necessary. And so, physically, we're all different. We probably all ate something different this morning. I don't know. I ate a piece of toast. I don't know about you, with some honey on it. No, actually, I didn't do honey this morning. I did that blue agave something. I don't know what it is. I was trying to be healthy. And so, some peanut butter. And I had some juice and stuff. And I don't know if you've ever heard of Ninja Red. I had a little bit of Ninja Red, too. Anybody that's into essential oils, I have a little bit of that. And so, it was all there burning and stuff. And anyway, I try to have variation in my life. When I get up, I don't know about you, everybody's different. I get ready for the day. And this morning I jumped up, I got in the shower, I did my typical thing. Some days I do this, some days I do that, some days I'm tired. I say, you know, I didn't sweat much yesterday, forget the shower, today's a bad day. And you know, so there's days like that, you know. And it happens. Usually there's an amount of maintenance that we have to do to our physical bodies. We all know that. Maybe some people are better at it than others, and we know that. Some people maybe have a less maintenance body, and they're just blessed. Some people may require a lot of maintenance, depending on how old you are and you know, your body type. Everybody's different. You know, some guys, if they want a clean shaved face, they're going to shave several times a day. You know, some guys, they trim their beard, whatever. You know, you look in the mirror, you might do something with your hair. You put deodorant on, whatever it is you do. Ever since I was a child, I got my clothes out the next day. There's preparation, some type of physical maintenance that we do every day. We eat, we sleep, we drink. At times we may cut our toenails, or we may have to get a hair trim. Maybe we even exercise. I don't know, but there is maintenance required. If we don't do anything, I don't know, the person didn't do anything to their body. They never washed it, they never took care of it, they never ate it, probably not. So even though God gives us life, and as we're born, we have this life at a certain time frame, we have to take care of it, or that'll be it. Same goes with a lot of things. You know, I don't know how you all got here this morning. I drove a little car. I've got a couple of different cars, and I took my little Chevy Malibu. It was actually bought it for my daughter from Kim the Rats. If you come here, we bought it from them when they moved out of the country. And I thought, you know, it's a nice little car. Didn't have any gas mileage on it. But it requires maintenance. I have to change the oil. We have to put gas in it because you know what? If the gas runs out, it's not going to go. Yeah, but it's a nice car. It didn't have many miles on it. Well, regardless, there's still things. You know, I have to put fluids in it. I have to check the tires. Sometimes I have to change the tire. Even though it's my car, there's things I have to do to it. Sometimes the better I maintain it, the longer I may have it. And that's really with anything. And this is just my work, if you want to call it that. This is one of my Bibles that I usually bring with me. I have to put my name on it so I won't lose it, or if it gets lost, I'll go, oh, this is, you know. I try to take care of my Bibles. I personally don't bark at them. If you're a barker up, that's fine. I used to be, but I keep them nice. I don't try to put a whole lot of marks in them. And I try to take care of them. I keep them nice on the bookshelf, and they last longer. You know, I don't just, throw it over here, throw it over there. And there are certain things in my life like that I like to take care of. Maybe some things not as much, like maybe my yard. I'm not the best yard keeper. I try, but it's just not my thing. You know, there are certain things maybe for you that you're better at taking care of and maintaining than in other things. It's just the way it is. You know, we're all different. Spiritually speaking, as God gives us new birth and He gives us His Son, there is an amount of maintenance that is required in order for us to continue to go forward. We're not just born again and then that's it. That's it. That's it. That's it. I don't have to do anything. That's totally it. All right. You know, there is maintenance that we do to our spiritual lives that will either help us or possibly hinder us in what we're doing. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about it this morning. Before I do that, I want you to thank those of you who kind of follow the Torah portion. The Torah portion has to do with giving, and they're bringing all this material. If you're hearing them reading, they brought gold and silver and bronze materials and oils. They brought all kinds of things. And those things are going to be used to create an outdoor, temporary, mobile worship place, a mishkan, a tabernacle. And so, as they were branding these things, one of the things that I was thinking about, and I just want you to think about this for a moment, where did they get those things? They were slaves. They had been slaves for hundreds of years. Typically, slaves don't have a lot of gold and silver and all that. If you remember, God instructed them to ask the Egyptians, when you go, you ask them. And it talks about Israel plundering the Egyptians. And I'm not going to go through all the details or all the numbers about how much they gave, but they gave a lot. I mean, they gave a lot of gold, a lot of silver, more than I've ever had. And a lot of all these valuable materials. Where did they get that? It belonged to the pagans. It belonged to the Egyptians who worshipped hundreds of false pagan gods. Well, why would God want to use that? You know, isn't that unholy? Isn't that pagan? Why would God take pagan things and create something out of those pagan things as a place of worship where His presence was going to be? Sometimes we laugh, and sometimes the word pagan is used a lot within certain groups. Oh, that's pagan. Don't do this. Oh, that's pagan. And I don't know if you know this or not, but every one of us were pagan at one time. Every one of us. But just as it's been mentioned this morning, God's called you. The Bible talks about you being the temple of the Spirit of God. Now, you were once pagan. was listening to a preacher on the radio, I guess it was yesterday, and he was saying, "Don't ever forget a memory that I just left here," and I was going down the road to do something. And he was just saying, "You know what? Don't ever forget where you came from. Don't ever forget where you were before your BC days, or before Christ days, as they call it. Before you were really born again, where you were at. Don't forget those days, because it keeps you humble. And sometimes God will use that past to help you minister to people." And this material was used, I don't know what all this material was used for in the past, but God was about to use it for something different. Don't be too hindered thinking, "Oh my gosh, that was just too evil." You might be surprised what God can do with evil men.
That's right.
I don't know if anybody who was born right on Messiah, who was born of the Virgin, but other than that, you know, none of us, we were all born in sin, the Bible says. But God uses us in spite of ourselves. God takes us. As they were giving, they had to later take those things and turn them into the things, and as God instructed them. But that wasn't the end of it. That there was maintenance. All this tabernacle took maintenance. And they had to light up the menorah, the candelabra, they had to keep the oil, they had to do the burnt, the incense, the bread they had to change out every week on the showbread. There was a lot of different things that they had to do to maintain this tabernacle, and they moved frequently. Not only that, they also had to move it a certain way. Only certain people move certain things, and they had to move it a certain way. So there was a process in maintaining what was going on here. It wasn't just build it, we're done, give it, we're done. There was other things that had to be done. Of course, we know, not necessarily in the order of how it was all set up, but they had the lampstand, the menorah, the altar of incense, the table of showbread, the ark, the altar of burnt offerings, and the laver, the place where they washed. And again, if you have a Bible, go to 1 Timothy chapter 4 with me. 1 Timothy is after the Thessalonians, which is after, you know, Galatians, Corinthians, all that. 1 Timothy is before James and Hebrews, in case you're wondering. 1 Timothy chapter 4. And I'm going to go ahead and start reading just here in verse 1, this whole chapter here. And again, I'm in 1 Timothy chapter 4. Now the Spirit expressly says that in the latter times some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons. You know, we're living in those days. We're living in those times. Beware. Speaking lies in hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry, and commanding to abstain from food which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and know the truth. For every creature of God is good, and nothing can be refused if it is received with thanksgiving, for it is sanctified by the word of God in prayer. If you instruct the brethren in these things, you will be a good minister of Yeshua, Messiah, nourished in the words of faith and of the good doctrine which you have carefully followed. But reject profane and old wives' fables, and exercise yourself toward godliness. For bodily exercise profits a little, but godliness is profitable for all things, having promise of the life that now is, and of that which is to come. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptance. For to this end we both labor, we work, we suffer reproach, because we trust in the living God, who is the Savior of all men, especially of those who believe these things command and teach. And I'll just stop right there for now. Actually, I'm going to go ahead and finish reading. There's not too much more. Verse number 12. Let no one despise your youth, but be an example to the believers, be an example of word and conduct and love and spirit and faith and purity. Till I come, give attention to reading, to exhortation, to doctrine. Do not neglect the gift that is in you, which was given to you by prophecy with the laying on of the hands of the eldership. Meditate on these things. Give yourself entirely to them, that your progress may be evident to all. Take heed to yourself and to the doctrine. Continue in them, for in doing this, you will save yourself and those who hear you. So it talks about there that your progress may be evident. Some people, their progress is evident and is due some people, they don't make much progress, and it has to do with where they're at, it has to do with the low maintenance. The Bible talks about, as far as evangelism, that the harvest is great, but the laborers are few. People don't want to work, people want to be lazy. The Bible says a lot about the spirit of laziness and about how dangerous it is for a believer. I want to talk about four different things this morning, just fairly briefly. Number one being prayer, and we talked about prayer last week if you were here. There's different kinds of prayer. We could say possibly even the lampstand represents prayer. Maybe the altar of incense could represent prayer. There's different types of prayers that we can pray. Petition prayer is when we ask God for things. Not only that, there's prayers of thanksgiving. Praying in the Spirit, our supplication in the Spirit. There's repentant prayers, maybe for ourselves or even for our generations or for our nation. We may enter into prayers of warfare, where we may be calling down strongholds. And then there's just prayers of fellowship, where it's just simple communication, talking and listening and expressing love. And that's just a few. There's a lot of different categories we can throw prayer in. But as far as our spiritual maintenance is concerned, prayer is a very important part of our spiritual maintenance. If we are going to truly be spiritually healthy, we need to maintain a prayer life of some form or fashion. We don't need to be legalistic about it. I know I spoke to a couple of people after service last week, kind of the Bible side of it. I'm not talking about a work system, and I don't mean making yourself pray to your, where it becomes a ritual, where it becomes something that you're gaining rally points. But prayer is extremely important in our relationship with God, and it affects everything, everything. Number two, the Word of God. And it, as we read there in 1 Timothy 4, he kind of covers some of these things. We need to spend time reading the Word of God, the Bible. We need to get a translation that we can understand, that we can read, and read easily. We need to study it, and there are different materials you can get to study it. We live in a time where knowledge is everywhere, where there's really going to be no excuses, where, I mean, there's material, and you need to ask God to help you. The flesh hates it. The flesh doesn't like it when we pray. The flesh does not like it when we get into the Word of God. The flesh would rather watch a movie, some exciting, adventurous drama, movie, whatever it is. The flesh would rather do something other than that. We should hear the Word of God. We can sing the Word of God. We should memorize it. We should meditate it. There's power in God's words. There's secrets within God's words. This will also help us in our prayers. If we don't really know God's will, sometimes it's hard to pray. There's even prayers within the scriptures that we can pray. Kind of like what our brother was doing. Sometimes he takes scriptures and makes them personal. He turns them into personal prayer, like a lot of the Psalms. And I mentioned this before, just in Ephesians, there's a couple of very profound prayers that Paul prays. And sometimes we do that. We do the at the end, typically on Friday night, when we're praying there from Numbers chapter 6, may the Lord bless you and keep you, His face shine upon you. That's a prayer that they pray. And there's a prayer, and sometimes it's prayed over the young men and the young women. It's also mentioned in the scriptures, may God make you as Ephraim and Menashe. And so these are prayers, biblical prayers. And, sometimes people find fulfillment in getting a Jewish prayer Siddur book and quoting prayers from that. And by all means, if it helps you, go for it. But if you feel like God's not going in that direction, don't feel like you have to. I believe there's all kinds of prayers that God can lead us in. There's books about prayer. There's examples of prayer. You can ask people to help you. Help me to know how to pray. I've heard so many people so many times say, I just don't know how. I just don't know how to pray. Last time to help you. Start reading the Bible and just start. I just don't know how to ride a bicycle. There's some people that pick up things quickly and they learn things quickly. A lot of times it's because of their attitude. They believe that it's because of their faith. Some people, they learn slow because they're fearful. They're afraid of things. Don't be afraid of kind of talk, don't you?
That's right.
Well, prayer is kind of like talking to God. It's not preaching a sermon. It's asking God for help. It's thanking God for answers, or maybe thanking God for future things, whatever it may be. There's a lot of different things within prayer. Anyway, the Word of God is important that we know God's Word. When the enemy came and tempted Messiah, the enemy knows the Word. I mean, he was quoting scriptures to Messiah, but then in return, Messiah said, "It is written." You know, the devil said, "Well, it's written, this, this, blah, blah, blah." And so Messiah says, "It is written again." The enemy may come against us, and sometimes like a bluff, but the Spirit of God will lift up a standard against them. The Bible says not to be we shouldn't be ashamed, but we should study to show ourselves approved, a workman that shouldn't be ashamed. And there's many categories in here where it talks about if someone wants to be a deacon, they need to know the Word of God. And deacon's only here to serve a lot of times. The deacons were just kind of servants. But part of the requirements were that they had to be men of faith, men of the Spirit, men that knew some of the Word of God. Many people get deceived. Many people fall into traps because they really don't know God's Word. They'd rather spend time getting regurgitated food. You know, we're not birds. I've never really had regurgitated food. I don't think I want it. I don't know if you've ever seen the mama bird. If you've seen the other side of the animal like that too. Gross, really. We as children, we drank the breast milk or whatever milk we were fed, and then we finally learned to eat the regular milk. But, the Bible talks about things. You that should be eating steak, you're still be drinking baby milk. You need to grow up, is kind of what he's saying. And so sometimes we're like, God, I don't know how to read the Bible. The enemy is a real delusionist. He's a real deceiver. I mean, he puts these thoughts into people's head. I don't know how to read the Bible. Don't listen to the lies of the enemy. I tell you what, you can and you will, and if you have the heart to do it, you can spend time and ask God to guide you. Sometimes you may have to say a prayer before and behind, and you may have to put the flesh in its place because the flesh isn't going to like it. I don't want to be sitting here reading the Bible. I need to be doing something. I mean, it's a sunny day out here. Yes, you can still do something. Find that balance in your life, but spend some time out, some time in the time frame. I'm not saying go overboard. Find balance, but at the same time, make sure you don't neglect this part of your life, the spiritual side of your life. Number three, I'm on number three now, moving right along here. Praise and worship. The Bible talks about in heaven that there's going to be a lot of worship. The Bible talks about in heaven that the angels continue to worship Him. Well, I don't sing. I don't play the instruments. That's not what I'm talking about. We can worship God with our mind, with our voice, maybe with music, with instruments, with dancing. There's a lot of different ways to worship and to honor God. This will tie right into prayer. That sometimes we pray, we make petitions, we ask God to help us, to help other people. But then there's times when we just need to spend time with Him, loving Him. You know, we sometimes say that, and those that are, traditionally say there in Deuteronomy 6, Shema Israel, I don't have a Bible, I don't have a, and then you go into the Be'ahata, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and your soul, and your strength. And so, how do we do that? Well, there's a lot of different ways. You just do it, with your mouth, with your mind, with your heart. He just said how to do it, with all your heart, with all your mind. Maybe you should have been a little more detailed. With your words, with your voice, it covers a lot of territory. With all of your heart, all your soul, all your mind. So expressing our faith in that manner is a powerful thing. A loving God is a powerful thing. When I had mentioned Smith Wigglesworth's work before about the presence of God being on him and other people similar, a lot of that took place because they were spending time loving God, not necessarily because they were spending a lot of time asking God, saying, "Give me this, give me this heart, give me this God, give me this boat, give me." It wasn't like that. Because he spent hours doing that, the presence of God was upon him. That's not what I'm talking about. But because he spent time just loving, I worship, just honoring God and praising Him and thinking that that's. There's a time to petition. I'm not saying it's wrong. There's times when they can just do better to do without. But I'm talking about just flowing with God's presence. And best times in many congregations, we have times of praise and worship. The Bible talks about this, and I'm moving right along. I'm going to hurry it up here. It's almost time for hot lunch. I don't know about you. Anyway, I've got to maintain my body here. So, I just lost. Sharing the good news of Messiah. It can also mean a comment this morning. Those of you that got up, you just told your blessed, no, you're not going to stay in bed. I'm going to make you get up and come here. And so I set my alarm. I got up at 6 because I get here early to do a couple different things and I've got to get myself ready, whatever. So I can pretty much that's the time I get up every morning. I got up and I don't know why my blessed was crying out because I went to bed late. My blessed was like, oh, you know. And I just had to say, you know what? No. I'll let you rest later. I know the body needs rest, and rest is good. But I just said, it's not time right now. You know, you're gonna yield to what I'm telling you. The flesh has a voice.
That's right. Yeah.
The enemy has a voice. The world has a voice. Yeah. Be careful who you're listening to.
Yeah.
Listening to the voice of God is good exercise. Just listening. Coming here this morning was a means of exercising. I can just worship at home. I can turn the TV on or whatever TV. God's with me every day, God everywhere. I mean, me and God got my own thing going on. I don't need this. Now, some people fall into that entrapment. And that is true. But at the same time, there's dangers in that.
Right.
God didn't say to do that. God, that's not the instructions in the Word of God. You coming here this morning shows that you were doing some exercising, following God's Word, resisting temptation. And I encourage you later, reading through that first end of the chapter 4 about some of the things he says there. It has to do with, what he's saying. Timothy was a young man, and he was saying, be an example in your word, in the way that you live, in your conduct, in how you love, in your faith, in your purity. Give attention to the Scripture. Don't neglect the gifts of God that may be in you. And apparently he had some gifts in him. And he said, think about them, meditate on them, and continue in them. And so, bodily exercise, it does profit a little bit. But godliness is profitable for all things, even your body. Believe it or not, that godly maintenance, spiritual maintenance, will affect your mind. It will affect your emotions. It will affect your body. It will be helpful in every realm. Not just temporary. I've seen people where they get to physical exercise and it's great.
Yes.
And it's good. But when they quit, you know, then they see the effects of it. Then they have to have something. They have to maintain it. And so sometimes you see these big bodybuilders, they get buffed up. And I remember probably every young man, or most every young man, at one point in their life, probably had that dream. I want to have a big muscle. I'm going to look like those. You know, I don't like it as a real young boy. I mean, I don't know. Man, let's work out, let's get buff, you know. I don't know, it's a man thing. But some of those guys who go overboard later, if they don't maintain, it gets rough for them. It gets hard carrying all that extra weight. some of it shrinks at the beginning. Like, I don't want to talk a lot about muscles, but I want to talk about spiritual muscles. And sometimes, just like muscles, in order to be strengthened, you have to work them. Sometimes our faith has to be worked. And so coming here this morning was an exercise of faith. Even in giving, we're exercising faith. Loving one another, praying for one another, worshiping God is exercising our faith. And so there's a lot of ways to exercise our faith. I'm just mentioning a few. What does faith look like? Well, it looks like someone loving God. It looks like someone loving one another. It looks like someone believing the Word of God and taking heed to it, reading and paying attention to it. There's a lot of different ways that faith looks. So I encourage you this morning, maintain yourself. You don't know how long you're going to be here. I don't know how long I'm going to be here. I don't care. I want to try to do as much maintenance and as I can. Sometimes it may be perfection stuff. Sometimes it may just be a little bit. Sometimes it may need a lot. I love winter times over here because I don't have to do much to my yard. I usually don't have to mow. I mean, it doesn't grow. It's just like, this is awesome. In the summer, I'm like mowing every couple of weeks. I'm like, oh my gosh, look at those. You know, sometimes it needs more maintenance than others, depending on what season you're in your life. And be sensitive to what season you're in. Be sensitive to God. You may be in a season where you need a lot of maintenance. You don't realize it. Then there are other seasons where God just kind of carries you along. Whatever the case is, you have a part to play. And so there are things that we are required to do that we have to do to help make this thing happen. Yes, we're born again. Yes, we have the Son of God given to us. Yes, we have salvation, eternal life. We have the Ruach HaKodesh, the Spirit of God. But we have to do something with all that. There's a part to play. And they got the gold and they got the silver and they got all these materials. But they had to do some stuff with it. They had to do some stuff with it. And so God's given you a lot of materials. All things that pertain to life and godliness. He's given to us. We need to start doing something with it. Oh, if I just had what I needed. You do. You just don't realize it. If I just had what I needed, I'd be a strong believer. You do have what you need. You just maybe don't realize it. You don't see it. Oh, no, I need more. I used to sing this song, more love, God. More love, more power, more of you. And God's probably saying, wait a second. I don't think he's saying that. I really don't think he's saying that. And it's a great song, and I do sing it. But doctrinally, if you were to critique it too much, you'd be thinking, wait a second, God's, he gave his son. It's available. Why are you having it? It's there. Take it. Why are you asking for it? Hello. Wake up. It's there. Sometimes we're asking for things from God, and it's right there in front of us. God, please give me this. Oh my goodness, please help me. And God is so merciful. It's amazing when you really begin to understand the depth and the heart of God. I mean, He is way beyond any of us as humans. I mean, we can understand a small amount, but you understand what he puts up with and how incredibly patient and understanding he is with all the different levels of his children. And it's incredible. I mean, as human, we're just like, we get crazy sometimes.